Good morning, and thank you for joining us. I'm Emily Velasco, and I'm a science writer in Caltech's Office of Strategic Communications. It is my pleasure to welcome you to Conversations on Sustainability. This series is hosted by the Caltech Science Exchange and gives us a chance to hear from scientists who are working on the cutting edge of research and technology that can mitigate the effects of climate change and help us live in a greener world. I'm joined today by Kimberly See, Assistant Professor of Chemistry, whose work is focused on developing batteries that can last longer, store more energy, and enable us to make the most of renewable energy sources. Kim, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me, Emily.
Of course. So we're going to talk about batteries today.
All right.
So my first question, this is kind of a loaded question, but I think a lot of people are probably wondering this. I know I hear a lot of complaints about this, but why are batteries so bad? It's always like everyone's phone is running out of batteries. Their laptops are running out of batteries. Why aren't batteries better than they are?
Batteries are actually really amazing at what they do. So if you think about what batteries used to be able to do, they can do a lot more than they used to be able to do since the 1990s. And that's because of the lithium-ion battery. It really revolutionized portable electronics and portable energy storage. But they do run out, so their capacity starts to decrease over time. And I think that's what you're talking about when you say, why are batteries so bad?
Yeah.
And that's why we have to, or we used to run around airports looking for chargers for our phones when we used to go to airports more often than we do now. And the reason why they end up running out of charge and they're able to store less and less charge over time is because of the complex mechanisms that are inside of the battery that allow it to store charge. So a battery, in order to store charge, which are electrons, when an electron is stored, there's an ion that moves to accommodate that's the stored electron. And that movement of ions causes changes in materials inside the battery. And then there's also issues with the interfaces between the electrodes. So a battery is composed of two electrodes and an electrolyte in between. And the electrodes sit at very high and low potentials. So the energies at those electrodes are high. So they can either be very reducing or very oxidizing. And in contact with that electrolyte in between, that causes some instability at that interface. And that can cause issues as far as how long your battery can last.
Yeah. So that kind of does lead into my next question, which now we've talked a little bit, but kind of if you could explain, like, what is going on when a battery wears out? Like when you have to buy a new battery for your laptop, like, what is actually happening in there? Could you describe the mechanism a little bit?
Yeah, so there are a lot of things happening in there. And this is actually an active area of research of trying to figure out exactly why batteries fail and why the capacity fades. But some of the reasons are these reactions at the interface are a big part of that. So especially a lithium ion battery, the anode of a lithium ion battery is at a very, very low voltage, which means it can reduce many things that come into contact with it, including the electrolyte that is in contact with it. And so that reduction causes the formation of a new film on the surface of that electrode. And that film is called the solid electrolyte interface. So you've probably heard of this term SEI, maybe if you've read some news reports about batteries, if you're as nerdy as I am. And the formation of the SEI contains lithium. So lithium is within that SEI. So your charge storage material, the material that needs to move in order for the electrons to be stored, gets taken up by the SEI. And so the more that forms, your lithium inventory essentially gets sucked into that phase. So that's one reason. Another reason is that lithium can get stuck in the materials at the two electrodes. So you have those two electrodes in the electrolyte. Lithium has to essentially move from one side to the other. And lithium has to do that with a very high efficiency. So when it's in one side of your electrode, it has to move to the other and then move back and forth. And sometimes it can get stuck. And so when it gets stuck, then you essentially lose the ability to store that electron that was moving with the lithium.
Okay. So it sounds like what's going on is that, like, one thing that's happening is that you're essentially losing the essence of the battery. It's getting stuck on the sides. And the other thing is that it's like the battery is getting kind of clogged, so things can't flow through it as well. Is that a good understanding of it?
Yeah, that's pretty good. Yeah.
Okay. So negatives aside, it does feel like batteries have come a long way in our lifetimes. I mean, we have lithium-ion batteries in it seems like just about everything now. So can you talk a little bit about how batteries have changed in the last few decades?
Sure. So batteries originally, the first batteries, you know, okay, so the first, very first battery was the voltaic pile that was invented in the late 1700s by Alessandro Volta. And that battery is what's called a primary battery, meaning that you can discharge the cell once and you can't recharge it. So these are things, we still use primary batteries all the time. So for example, in your TV remote, you have a primary battery. When it runs out, you don't plug it into the wall, you put a new battery in and you dispose of that cell. So that was, you know, that was the status quo for a long time. And then rechargeable cells came about after that. So these are called secondary batteries. So these are batteries that when they discharge, you can plug them into a wall and recharge them. And the mechanisms inside those two kinds of batteries is very different. So in one, you can do the forward reaction, the reaction that allows the electrons to flow one direction and in the spontaneous direction. And then in a secondary cell, you can do that forward reaction, the spontaneous reaction, but then you have to push the electrons back the other direction in the non-spontaneous reaction by applying energy. And that's what you do when you plug it into a wall. So the mechanisms are very different and you need different chemistries inside of the batteries to do that. And what happened in the 1990s was the invention of the lithium-ion battery. So Sony commercialized that battery in 1991. And that battery is composed of very novel materials relative to what came before. So the mechanism by which it stored charge was fundamentally different than like a nickel cadmium battery or nickel metal hydride battery that was sort of the status quo rechargeable cell before that. And so what happens in a lithium ion battery is that you have lithium ions that shuttle from one side of the cell to the other, and the materials that host the lithium don't change very much in response to that lithium moving in and out. So you can imagine like a sandwich, let's say, and the lithium can kind of slide in between the bread and then slide back out. So this is a process called intercalation. The lithium intercalates in between the sheets and then it deintercalates, and the sheets don't change very much in response. Whereas before, the materials that were used, you had a similar reaction in that you had an ion that was being incorporated into a material, but that incorporation caused a massive change in the material. And then it was released and the material changed a lot again. So intercalation allows you to do that and not change your host material very much. And so that's why lithium ion batteries were so revolutionary, was one, they don't change in response to the lithium moving in and out of the material, which again is what allows you to store electrons. So as lithium is incorporated, an electron is introduced, because lithium has a positive charge. So lithium goes in, you have an electron that comes in. When lithium is removed, the electron is released. So that was a huge revolution in the mechanism of storing charge. And that's what won the Nobel Prize a few years ago, was this intercalation chemistry. The other reason that lithium ion batteries are so amazing is because of their high energy density. So the amount of lithium that you can store per unit mass or volume of the material is really, really high compared to all other materials that came before it. And the voltage that you can get out, so the number of electrons is really important, and then the voltage that they carry that is also very important. So those two things give you the energy of the cell, and the voltage that the electrons carry in a lithium ion battery is also very high.
For people that aren't familiar, could you real briefly describe what does energy density mean?
Yeah, so in battery terms, when we're talking about energy density, we're talking about the volt of an electron and the number of electrons. So the energy that the potential energy that it carries in some ways, and then the number of electrons you can store. So if you take the voltage times the amperage, you get the wattage, and that gives you the energy density of the cell.
Okay, so it's kind of like how much energy you can pack into a given space. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah. So there's two things that you have to worry about. And depending on the application, one or the other might be more important. So that there's gravimetric energy density. So we either normalize it to mass or we normalize it to volume, the volumetric energy density. And depending on your application, you know, one of those can be way more important than the other. So if you think about like your cell phone, for example, you might not care if your cell phone weighs a couple, you know, another ounce or two, but you would care a lot if your phone was another 2 or 3 millimeters thicker. So volumetric energy density means a lot when you're talking about like cell phones, for example.
For sure. So lithium batteries right now seem to be the gold standard, at least in consumer technology, but researchers like you are working on the next generations of batteries. So what does that research look like?
Yeah, so next generation battery research is all about, you know, moving beyond lithium ion, as you said. So our benchmark is lithium ion, and we're trying to be better than that. And being better than that can mean a lot of different things. So you can think of different metrics like capacity, which we've already talked about. So this is the number of electrons I can store in the material, or the energy density, which is the number of electrons and the voltage that they carry. Or I can think about where my materials in the battery come from. So lithium ion batteries contain resources that are somewhat problematic. So things like cobalt, nickel, and lithium, they aren't the most sustainable elements to have in a technology that's gonna be widespread across the world. And if you imagine the world going to an all electric fleet, that would mean a lot of lithium, a lot of cobalt, and a lot of nickel. So going towards more sustainable systems. And so what my group tries to do is we think a lot about the sustainability aspect. So we try to use materials that are more abundant and more sustainable and less expensive than what's currently used in lithium ion batteries, but that could hopefully hit energy density targets that would make them relevant for certain applications. So that's what we work on.
Okay. So if we could like kind of take a step backward a little bit, how did you become interested in batteries? Like what appealed to you about them?
I was always really interested in energy research. I think like a lot of young scientists, you know, you see the climate crisis and you see the issues that we have with our energy infrastructure and you want to fix that problem. And that's why I ended up going to grad school and studying science in general. I'm a chemist by training. So I saw chemistry as a way to help solve these problems. And when I got to grad school, I had some background in electrochemistry. So I did a little bit of research in water splitting. So this is taking water and splitting it into hydrogen and oxygen, which are fuels. And so I knew I really liked electrochemistry. And I also really liked solid state chemistry. So this is understanding how solids react, what the atoms do within a solid if we perturb them in some way. And batteries were the perfect marriage between those two disciplines, between electrochemistry and solid state chemistry. And I just got really, really lucky in grad school. And I worked for an advisor that had a project in battery chemistry. I remember when I went to grad school, I didn't even know that people researched batteries. You know, you might think that batteries are like a solved problem. And, you know, I have five in my house at any one time. And so why is there research still going on there? So I was excited to learn about how batteries can fit into sort of the bigger picture of sustainability, and also how we can think about making batteries better. So I just got really lucky. I was able to marry these two sort of fundamental interests into something that I was passionate about on a personal level.
Yeah. So you just kind of alluded to this, but how do batteries fit into plans for renewable energy? Like what role do batteries play in the development of renewable energy sources?
Yeah, batteries play a pivotal role in renewable energy resources. And I shouldn't say batteries, I should say energy storage. So in order for intermittent renewable energies to really impact the grid, we need to get rid of this intermittent part, you know? So we only have wind when the wind's blowing and sun when the sun is shining. And that's an issue with the type of energy consumption that we require as a society. So in order to bypass, or in order to, I guess, alleviate that, we need storage in order for that energy to be used when it's needed and not necessarily when it's produced. Okay. And so energy storage plays a huge role in that. And right now, batteries don't play in that area at all. Really, there are some installations of grid storage battery packs, but they're sort of mostly proof of concept type systems for the most part. And that's because we have such reliable energy from burning coal, for example. There's no need to store intermittent renewables because we have this really nice baseline of on-demand power.
You can burn coal whenever you need it, essentially, right?
Yeah, that's right. And it's pretty cheap. So that's a huge, and that's great. I mean, that's the way that we're able to live the lives that we do. So what would be really great though, is if we could come up with a really sustainable and inexpensive energy storage solution that would propel wind and solar into that same regime of something like coal. We probably won't get that cheap, but hopefully we can get closer to it so that we can, you know, incentivize the use of renewable energies on the grid to decarbonize the grid.
Yeah. And so the problem with renewable energies right now is that, like, say everyone needs electricity, it's the winter and everyone wants their lights on because it's 7 o'clock at night, but there's no sun out and it's been cloudy all day. So you don't have like a good source of power. And that's the gap that we're trying to bridge, right? That you can generate electricity at one point and then use it later. Is that the right understanding?
Yeah, that's right. And there are different timeframes associated with that. So you can think of daily storage, like sort of what you're talking about, where, well, you kind of mixed two different kinds of storage there. So, because you have the seasonal part of it where, you know, it's winter, you don't have as much sun, but you also have the night day part of it. So there's different time requirements associated with different parts of the world. So, you know, depending on when you have these resources, you might need to store it for 8 hours to use it at night, or you might need to store it for 6 months to use it in the winter when you don't have sun so much. And those types of storage requirements require different kinds of chemistry, fundamentally different kinds of chemistry within the battery, because you can imagine a battery that sits fully charged for 6 months is very different than a battery that sits fully charged for 8 hours.
Yeah, that makes sense. So what needs to happen with our battery technology for us to make better use of these renewables?
So for renewables in particular, I would say that the biggest metric we really need to think about is cost. So cost, dollars per kilowatt hour, is the thing that we really need to worry about. And that sort of goes hand in hand with resource considerations. So if we're storing a lot of energy in an electrochemical device, in a battery, that's going to be a big battery. So you want to use materials that you can find all over the world that are also less expensive, so that the cell itself is less expensive, but also so that we don't have a huge issue with resource availability, like what we're seeing now with cobalt and nickel, for example, with lithium ion. So cost and resource availability, and like I said, those two kind of go hand in hand, but low cost materials are typically easier to get than high cost materials. And so those are the things we need to think about if we're going to target something like grid storage.
Okay. Now there are forms of grid storage right now, right? Like pumped hydro, like how does that, like, you know, where are we at with like economics wise or cost wise for batteries versus things like pump? And if you could explain pumped hydro too, real quick, like how do they compare?
Yeah. So the US in particular doesn't have much grid storage right now. And that's because we have such reliable baseline forms of energy like coal and nuclear, some nuclear. But there is some storage, and that storage is mostly in the form of what you say, which is pumped hydro. So pumped hydro is basically taking water, pumping it up a hill when you have energy, and then letting it run down the hill when you need energy. And so it's a very simple form of energy storage. And it works really, really well. And it's very inexpensive. There's a pretty large capital cost with building pumped hydro plants. But once you've built the plant, it's very inexpensive. The downside of pumped hydro is that it's somewhat geographically limited, because you need, A, you need a hill to pump it up, and B, you need somewhere to store all the water, because the water is essentially what's storing your energy for you. The water is sitting on top of the hill. So you have to have an area for a big lake or something like this. Mm-hmm. And so those two things make it somewhat limited in where you can apply pumped hydro. But it is very inexpensive. So batteries are not there yet. They are certainly not reaching the cost of a pumped hydro facility. And again, it depends on how long that facility is alive, because a lot of that cost is in the capital cost. But we're not there yet. So the cost of batteries needs to come down quite a bit. But also you have to take into account that batteries are a lot more versatile than pumped hydro as far as where you can deploy them. So that might be a benefit if you were looking for an energy storage solution where you couldn't do pumped hydro.
Yeah. What do you think of commercial energy storage systems like the Tesla Powerwall, like little essential like grid storages, but just inside of someone's house? Are those helpful or no?
I think there's a place for them for sure. I think that these, you know, personal energy storage systems that let you kind of have your own microgrid at your house are very interesting and exciting for a lot of reasons. I think that, you know, if you could have solar panels on your roof and a energy store, a battery bank in your house to store that energy, that could make you completely independent of the grid, which there's a lot of reasons that people would want to do that. And there's also a huge benefit to these smaller storage installations for remote areas. So if you think of places that don't have the infrastructure to bring power lines to that place, then you can, it's much, in a lot of cases, it's a lot simpler to install, you know, a combo PV storage type microgrid in order to bring power to these remote locations. So I think from that perspective, they're really, really good. I think that, you know, if you were thinking about what are we going to do in LA to really affect our carbon footprint, I'm not sure that, you know, everyone's going to buy a huge battery to put in their house. I don't think that's going to happen. So I think that something needs to happen on a community level in order to really move the needle in sort of these bigger areas.
Yeah. I mean, some of us live in apartments and have no place for power walls. So,
exactly.
Yeah. So you talked a little bit earlier about some of the negative impact of using materials like lithium and cobalt. You alluded to them, but can you talk a little bit about like, what are the actual like downsides to using materials like lithium and cobalt? Like what are the human and environmental costs there?
Yeah, so the primary sort of workhorses of a lithium ion battery are lithium, cobalt, and nickel. So nickel has taken over a lot of the load that cobalt used to carry. And that's because of all of the issues associated with cobalt. So lithium, we'll start with lithium. Lithium is like the ideal charge storage material. It's small, it's lightweight, and it has a really low reduction potential, which means that you can store a lot of energy. So for all of those reasons, lithium is amazing. From a resource perspective, lithium is it's not rare, but it's not found everywhere, right? So lithium is primarily found in what's called the ABC triangle. So Argentina, Bolivia, and Chile in South America. So there it's mined in these salt flats. And mined is actually a pretty strong word. It's literally sort of sitting on top of the earth. So it's easy to get there. It's also found in Australia as well. So Australia actually produces a lot of lithium as well. Australia has a lot of land and a lot of minerals. So there's lithium in Australia as well. So the downside of lithium itself is that there is a finite resource of lithium, and it's more finite than other alternatives. So if we were to think of, you know, something like what we work on, like magnesium or calcium or zinc, all of those materials are orders of magnitude more abundant and found all over the world. So those could ostensibly alleviate some of the issues associated with lithium. That being said, lithium is not going to be replaced anytime soon. Lithium is an incredible chemistry. It works really well. And for all of those reasons, it's going to be around for a long time. And so the question is, where do we put our lithium resources? I think that's how you should think about it is, you know, if I have a finite number of batteries I can eventually build from the lithium resources that I have, where do I want those batteries to go? Yeah. And it's in my opinion, they're probably going to go into EVs. So there's going to be, you know, there's a huge push to go away from internal combustion engine vehicles. There's already a lot of infrastructure that's been built in the US, especially for electric vehicle charging. And so it seems like that's where we're going. We're going towards, and by electric vehicle, I mean battery electric vehicles, because you can have a fuel cell electric vehicle as well. But that infrastructure isn't quite as developed as what you can do with a battery electric vehicle. I think, you know, in California, for example, you know, we're going to be all electric sold cars by 2035, according to the governor. So that's pretty soon. That's like, you know, 14 years from now. So that's going to require a lot of lithium, even just for the California market. So if you think about where that lithium is going, I think it's going to go into EVs. So in order to target other applications, we need to think of other chemistries. And then if we think about cobalt and nickel, so those are the other two that I mentioned. Cobalt, there are significant humanitarian issues associated with cobalt mining. Cobalt is primarily mined in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and there's not a whole lot of government oversight to those mines. And so there's issues with child labor, and also cobalt is a toxic substance in some forms. And so it causes a lot of health issues. There's been a lot of environmental issues also with those mines in the DRC. And then nickel, nickel is not the most abundant metal, but it's not the least abundant metal. The problem with nickel is that it's expensive. So getting a lot of nickel, it makes the cell more and more expensive, because right now it seems like for the chemistry, you either need a lot of cobalt, and whatever cobalt you replace it with nickel. And so as you replace more and more of that with nickel, the cell gets more expensive. So those are the issues with resources in lithium ion batteries. And that's what a lot of the field is working on, is trying to get rid of cobalt and nickel from the cathode. So it's at one side of the electrode is called the cathode. That's where the cobalt and the nickel are. So there's a lot of work trying to get rid of that.
All right. Well, what developments are you most excited about in battery research right now? I hear a lot of people talk about solid state batteries. It seems to be kind of a hot topic in the news. And like, what's going on with solid state batteries, and what are you excited about right now?
Solid state batteries are exciting. From a fundamental perspective, they're really cool. They're very cool. So a normal battery has two electrodes and an electrolyte, and that electrolyte is usually composed of a liquid. In this case, in lithium ion batteries, that liquid is an organic solvent, and that organic solvent is flammable. And so there are issues associated with safety and using flammable solvents in systems where you can have heating events. So moving away from flammable solvents means going towards solid state materials. So replacing that electrolyte with a solid. And the primary, job of the electrolyte is to allow the ions to move from one side to the other, but prevent the electrons, because you want the electrons to flow through the external circuit and power your phone or your car or whatever. So now you need to do that with a solid. You need to move ions through a solid.
That seems like a challenge, right? Like moving materials through something that's solid.
Yeah. So intrinsically, ions move easier in a liquid than in a solid, because there's atoms moving around in a liquid, and in a solid, they're locked in place. But there are materials that can conduct lithium actually at the same rates that liquids can. So these are called superionic conductors. And it's very interesting how these work, and there's a lot of really fun fundamental science that we're working on in this area, and other people at Caltech are working on in this area as well, and trying to understand how the ions move through these solids. So from a fundamental perspective, they're fascinating. And from a practical perspective, they're very, very hard. So difficult to work with, difficult to get the devices to work. So making an all solid state device is really, really challenging. And a lot of that has to do with those interfaces that I was talking about. So you have your solid, and now if you imagine that your electrolyte was a liquid, so we'll start there, and you put it against a solid, that liquid can wet the solid and make a nice interface for you. Now imagine that you have two solids and you squish them together, and now you need to think about that interface, and that interface is a lot more challenging because you don't have that same wetting capability that a liquid would have that you do with your solids. And there's there's a lot of challenges with solid state batteries, but there's additional challenges associated with the stability of the solid at that interface. There's reactions that can happen there. And also preventing the electrons, but allowing the ions to move is challenging as well. So solid state batteries have been in the news a lot lately, because there have been a few companies, that one that went public and one that's going public. And so there's been a lot of interest in that area. So there seems to be, at least from a commercial perspective, steps in the right direction as far as commercializing solid state lithium cells. And the really exciting part of that is that people are using lithium metal anodes. So one of the benefits of a solid state device, in addition to safety, is that you might be able to use a lithium metal anode instead of a graphite anode. So I talked about how ions can move in and out of the bread of a sandwich. So imagine now you take away the bread and you just have the ion. It's sort of similar to that. So you take away all of this extra weight that you had there. And now you just take the lithium ion and you reduce it to the metal. And that's a huge, 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 huge increase in energy density. So there's a lot of benefits to doing that, but there are safety issues associated with that that we could talk about, but I realize it's 11:30 already. Mm-hmm. And but suffice to say that the solid state electrolytes could alleviate some of the safety issues associated with lithium plating, with lithium metal.
Yeah. Okay. So my last question, and then we'll take some audience questions, is if you had to put on your fortune teller's hat, what would you say that batteries are going to look like in 10 years?
In 10 years, I think they'll look a lot like they do now. Yeah. I think from anybody's perspective, from a user's perspective, they're not going to be that much different. The chemistry inside them might change a little bit. And there might be improvements here and there to increase, you know, energy density percentages. There are some increases we can do just based on the chemistry of the cell that we haven't gotten to yet. They're not huge, but there's some area there. So I think they're going to look very similar in 10 years. I think, you know, in 20 years, I think things are going to change a little bit. I think there's a lot, you know, these solid state cells might have a pretty big impact on the market. You might think about new applications for batteries. So, you know, eventually what we would love to do is have, electric aircraft. So if you have electric aircraft and you have a battery on that aircraft, that would be a huge impact on CO2 emissions from airplanes. So we'd like to get there eventually. So I don't know when that's going to happen. I think that there's a lot of fundamental science that needs to happen before we get there. But that's something that people are really pushing towards. So I don't think that's the 10-year mark, but in the future, someday, hopefully we'll have electric aircraft.
Are there any really just wild battery theories or technologies that are like way off, but people are thinking about? Is there any really wild stuff that people are thinking about right now?
I think from my perspective, you know, sometimes people try to marry biology and batteries together, and that always just blows my mind because I don't understand biology at all. But, you know, there's these like virus batteries or something that I don't understand. But so those are kind of crazy. I think there are, you know, there's a lot of work on really exciting systems that get a lot of media attention that have sort of fundamental flaws that aren't talked about. And I won't name any of those, but they look very exciting on the surface. And then you think about them a little bit harder and you wonder why only one paper was published, you know? So, yeah. So those are fun, but I think in general, you know, the community is really working towards systems that can make a difference and that can impact, you know, applicable systems. So I think that's something that we're all really trying to work hard towards. And I think what's really exciting is that there are so many options. You know, if you look at the periodic table, there's a lot of elements on there that you can think about using. And so, you know, you want to limit yourself in some degree. And in my group, we limit ourselves to things that are sustainable and inexpensive. And so that narrows it down quite a bit. But even then, there's a lot of different combinations that you can think about. So there's a lot of work towards new chemistries that are all very exciting for different reasons. And I think that all of them have, you know, a place and will be exciting to see where the research goes. So it's a very active field.
Yeah, very cool. You ready for some audience questions?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. So I think this is a good question because I think other people have wondered about this. As the use of lithium-ion batteries increases, what are we doing about like the safe disposal of used batteries? Like, can they be recycled? Like, what happens to batteries when they're dead? Like, and what do we do with them?
Yeah, that's a really great question. I think this is something that will be more and more important. And especially, I think, like, you know, you talk about 10 years from now, and 10 years from now, we really need to know what to do. And we don't right now. So I would say, you know, there's not a lot of research into recycling. There's some. I think that, and actually I've thought about how my group can contribute in this area as well, because I think it's really important. But understanding, how do I take a cell apart? How do I get the materials out that I want to refurbish, for lack of a better word, and build a cell that's just as good as the original one? You know, that's the dream. We're not there at all. Actually, most of the lithium ion batteries that are recycled, we don't recycle many of the metals in the cells. We don't recycle the things you would think, the nickel, the cobalt, the aluminum, the lithium. We recycle, or sorry, the aluminum we do recycle. But it's not from the active material. It's from like the casings and things.
Yeah.
And that's because the casings are easy to get, and it's easier to do that. So I think there's a lot of work that needs to go into that, especially if we're going to think about, you know, how do I do a life cycle analysis of a battery? I think that's really important. You don't want to just have, you know, make a bunch of lithium ion cells and then, you know, okay, let our children's children worry about this problem of all these lithium ion cells. Let's figure out how to take them apart and refurbish the materials so that we can make new cells that work just as well, and just make this a closed loop. That's the dream. But there's not a lot of work in that area. So I think that's something that needs to ramp up, in my opinion. And I don't know how we can contribute yet, but I've been thinking about that. And I think that the other thing you can think about instead of taking it apart and taking the materials out is if I have a battery, you know, let's say I have a battery in my electric car. My electric car could go 300 miles. Now it can only go 220 because my battery capacity has faded. Okay, well, that might not be great from my electric car, but that would be a perfectly fine battery to use for grid storage or something like this. So these second usages, second use models of how do I take a cell that doesn't have the capacity that it did, but it's still working pretty darn well. How do I use that and keep it in the loop of storing energy and do it that way? So there's some work thinking about that. So how do we use second use batteries for grid storage?
I can say personally, so I have an electric scooter that has lithium batteries in it, and the old battery pack has slowly like lost its capacity. So, you know, instead of being able to go 20 kilometers, I could only go 12. And so I took it out and I've just been stealing the battery cells out of it to use in my electronics projects, because they're fine for like powering little art projects and things. They just don't get around town. So yeah.
There you go.
Okay. Another question is, someone wants to know, like, how do you prototype new battery chemistries? Like what's the nuts and bolts in your lab? Are you doing computational chemistry and then like, you know, simulating them on a computer, or are you like actually sitting there building little batteries and testing them? Or is it both?
We do both now. So we used to be a purely experimental group, and then COVID happened. And so like a lot of experimental groups, we started dabbling in computation. And so luckily I have a really talented postdoc who was really interested in this. So he, and a new graduate student actually, who has some background in this and very talented in this as well. And so they've sort of spearheaded this theoretical part of my group, where they're looking at computationally predicting new materials, which is traditionally been a really tough area. It's really hard to say, like, you know, these are the properties I want. What material should I make? Like, that's the dream of computation. And that's really, really tough. And so they've been working along those lines of looking at different types of ion conductors. So we do a little bit of that, but most of my group is experimental, which means that we go in the lab, we make materials, we fabricate them into electrodes, we put them into cells, and we measure their electrochemistry. And so we're making little tiny cells in the lab all the time. So if you've ever had a button cell in your watch, these little tiny, you know, round cells, we make those all the time. So those are called coin cells. They come in different sizes. And so we make those, and we make other geometries. The cell geometry doesn't matter so much at this scale, because we're at, you know, academic scales of just looking at small quantities. And then if we saw, you know, the main focus of my group is understanding why. So if we see electrochemistry, we want to understand why this material is doing what it does. So we think about things on the atomic scale and think about what the electronics are doing and which atom is being oxidized and reduced and how's the structure responding and all of those things. So that's the primary goal of my lab, is to really develop this fundamental understanding to use that to understand how to make new materials. You know, eventually what we would like to do is, once we have a material that's very interesting, you would start to scale that up. So the prototyping you're talking about. So you would go from these sort of academic small scale cells, and you would start scaling that up to larger and larger cells. So the next round of scale up for prototyping typically goes to what's called a pouch cell. So these are larger area devices that maybe are the size of my hand, or maybe bigger, maybe, you know, a little bit, 1.5 times the size of my hand. And they look like little pouches, and they have your cell stack inside, electrode, electrolyte in between, and tabs coming out for electric contacts. And then you would prototype on that. So there's a lot of engineering actually. So there, batteries are very interdisciplinary, battery research. So it goes all the way from, you know, physics and chemistry all the way up to engineering and you know, battery management systems and all these things that are I don't understand very well. So, you know, once you get to this prototyping stage, there's a lot of engineering work that goes into optimizing how do you make your electrodes? How do you make consistent material? How do you combine all of these elements together to make a cell that works really well? How do you fabricate the cell? That's a huge, huge challenge also. So once you change the chemistry, all of those things have to happen again. And so that's how we would do it.
Okay. I think we've probably got time for like two more questions. And so one question is, I mean, they just say, what do you think of iron air batteries? And I tried to Google this real quick and I didn't get a full answer, but maybe you know a little bit more about iron air batteries. And if you do, could you explain what they are and what applications they might have?
So I don't know exactly what this question is asking. Okay. So there's a lot of very, you know, like I said, so you can take basically any two redox reactions. If they have a positive voltage between the two, you can make a battery. Yeah. So you can imagine all kinds of combinations. So I would imagine that an iron air battery, you have an air cathode. So air batteries were really exciting. I don't know, maybe 15 years ago, I would say, where people were working on lithium air. So lithium air has an air cathode and a lithium metal anode. And what it means to have an air cathode is that you are taking oxygen from the air and reducing it. That's your reduction reaction at the cathode. So that's very different than how a conventional cell works in that you have, it's all enclosed. Everything happens in the solid state. In an air battery, you have gaseous air coming into your battery, reducing to a solid, and that happens in your cell. So these are commercialized, air batteries are. So a zinc air battery is an example of a commercialized device. It's used in hearing aids, for example. Mm-hmm. So air flows into the cell and it's reduced. And the benefit there is huge because air is free, essentially, right? So you just pull in oxygen out of the air. And it's around and you don't have to store it, like you just pull it out of the air. And the energy densities are huge. So a lithium air cell, if it worked, could be as energy dense as gasoline. It's the only chemistry that can do that. Okay. But there's a lot of challenges associated with lithium air. And then if you were to talk about, and we could talk about that, but there's a lot of reactive substances that form on the electrode when you reduce oxygen to the oxide. And those cause a lot of problems. And also there's a lot of issues with only using air and not just pure oxygen, et cetera.
Yeah.
But an iron air battery would have a lower voltage than a lithium air battery. So Okay. The voltage would be a lot lower, but it would have a lot of those same complications associated with the cathode. So the way to think about iron air is to compare it to zinc air. So if you were really interested in looking at iron air chemistry, I would compare it to what the zinc air chemistry is doing. And so those are probably primary systems that you just discharge once. And so the applications for those are very different than what you would have for like a rechargeable system.
Okay. And so it sounds like, I mean, with all these like metal air batteries, it's, and this is the wrong term, but it's kind of like the metal that's in there rusts. Well, it's exposed to the air. And I know rust is just for iron, but it's essentially rusting and making electricity as it does it. Is that how they work, basically?
Yeah, that's a great way to put it.
Okay. Yeah. All right. I think one last question. And this one is kind of interesting. This comes from a student. And this student wants to know if you, and if you're not, maybe if you know of anyone else is doing this, are you working on batteries that can, well, there's multiple questions here, but are you working on batteries that can work on other planets or for use in space? And if so, like what would be the challenges there? And if you have any general advice for students who want to go into this field?
Okay, so the batteries in space field.
Yeah.
We do work on that. So being at Caltech, you know, we're so lucky to be associated with JPL and having the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, you know, right next door. And there's a really great group there that works on batteries for missions. And their whole goal is basically to support missions with batteries that work for their applications. So that's really diverse. And what's really fun about that is you know, we don't necessarily care too much about cost. So this is like the complete opposite of everything else that we do. Everything else that we do, we're worried about like resource considerations and costs and all of these things. And then, you know, when we work with JPL, we're like, let's throw a bunch of fluorine in here. So, you know, we don't care how much this thing's going to cost. So fluorinated materials are typically expensive. So we had one project with them where we were looking at a mission that was aimed at an aerial mission to Venus. So looking at the Venus atmosphere, I guess the Venus atmosphere is somewhat similar to Earth's. And so there's a lot of interest in having missions go to Venus to study the atmosphere. But the challenge is to have an aerial vehicle in the atmosphere of Venus. There's a pretty interesting temperature range there. So it's 120 C above the clouds and around, you know, it's around 25 or something below. So you need to be able to work, or sorry, I flipped that. You need to be able to have a battery that works in that temperature range. Yeah. So we were working on electrolytes, actually. This was an electrolyte project that we thought might be able to do this. And they're very interesting electrolytes that are sort of they're sort of a hybrid between a liquid and a solid in some ways that would allow us to work at those temperatures. So that was a really fun project. And now we have another project with JPL that's looking at different types of chemistries for other missions to space that I can't talk too much about, but that's something that we also work on with them. But there's a whole group at JPL who works on that. So if you're interested in getting into that kind of research, you know, depending on where you are in your training, you know, you want some electrochemistry experience, and, you know, depending on what kind of research you want to do you want to research the chemistry or do you want to research the more engineering aspects? So those two things are very different. So you would need a background on one or the other.
Yeah. Okay, great. Well, we're out of time. So this was fun. This was a really fun conversation. So thank you so much for joining us. And thank you to everyone out there for joining us as well. For more information on the research being conducted in the C Lab, you can go ahead and visit C Group, and that's SEE Group. Caltech.edu. And in the meantime, if you're interested in exploring more science-driven discussions for a warming planet, please check out the Caltech Science Exchange. The site provides trustworthy answers and clear explanations on critical topics in science and technology. You can find that at scienceexchange.caltech.edu. And thanks again, Kim.
Thank you so much, Emily. Mm-hmm.